workers in strike here in Delano are appalled at the shooting of Marcelino Barajas and Paul Salgado. We've known now for over 10 years that the strike breakers and the growers are armed. We communicated this to Sheriff Wiley. There's been now, this is the eighth incident where we have had shootings at us. Last week, 5 days ago, another striker was wounded when a strike breaker or a grower, we don't know who, from inside the fields, fired through the rear window of the car and injured him in the back. We had a number of men jailed and beaten, and we cannot get the sheriff to tell us the whereabouts of their names. We estimate about 20 people were arrested at the Masekian Ranch a while ago when these men were beaten, and they will not tell us the whereabouts of the people who are beaten, how seriously they are, or they will not tell us how many people are in jail or in which jail they are. We want the sheriff's department investigated. We want to know why the sheriff refuses to go into the fields and take the arms away from those men. We also want to know why the sheriff is making a special point of these raids and these beatings on our picket lines. Brother Juan Cervantes, a 19-year-old picket captain, was threatened, was told by one of the sheriff's deputies in that goon squad, was told that, "We're gonna kill you, son of a bitch. We know where you live and we've got your license plates." And several of the picket captains have received that kind of treatment from this outlaw cops. And we want that stopped, and it's gotta be stopped immediately. Calling us greasers, dirty Mexican greasers, calling us spicks, and it's really uncalled for.
Cesar Chavez was a community organizer, farm labor rights, and civil rights activist who dedicated his life's work to what he called la causa, the cause, which is the struggle for farm workers in the United States to improve their working and living conditions through organizing and negotiating contracts with their employers. Cesar Chavez was known as a crusader for the environment, consumer rights, and he also championed nonviolent social change. A first-generation American, he was born in Yuma, Arizona on March 31, 1927. At age 11, his family lost their farm during the Great Depression and became migrant farm workers in California. Cesar worked in the fields full-time to help support his family. Throughout his youth and into adulthood, Cesar traveled the migrant streams throughout California, where he encountered many injustices of farm worker life.
The situation is basically one of a lack of protection for the farm worker under the National Labor Relations Act. We do not have collective bargaining rights, which would give us a right to hold secret ballot elections to let the farm worker decide for himself whether or not he wants a union. What, of course, gives the impetus to all of this is the fact that the poor working conditions of the migrant worker, it's the third most hazardous industry in the United States. The fact that the farm workers were excluded from unemployment insurance, health benefits, that we don't have toilets in the fields, for example, washing facilities, many times not even cold drinking water in 100-degree weather. And then also I think perhaps we can just mention, for example, one statistic. The life expectancy of the 3 to 4 million farm workers in this country, 49 years.
With only an 8th grade education, Cesar joined the U.S. Navy in 1946 in the aftermath of World War II and served in the Western Pacific for 2 years. Cesar's career in community organizing began in 1952, joining the San Jose chapter of the Community Service Organization, which was the most prominent Latino civil rights group of its time. Cesar spent 10 years with the CSO as a grassroots organizer, coordinating voter registration and get out the vote drives, leading campaigns against racial and economic discrimination, and organizing new CSO chapters across California.
Compañeras y compañeros estudiantiles de la Universidad de California en Los Ángeles, es un placer para mí estar con ustedes hoy este día. Brothers and sisters, it's a pleasure for me to be here with you this afternoon to talk to you about some of the problems that we're confronted with, to bring you a message from the farm workers, and to ask you to support us.
Chavez resigned from the CSO in 1962 after other members refused to support his efforts to form a labor union for farm workers. The same year, he used his life savings and founded the National Farm Workers Association in Delano, California, which later became the United Farm Workers of America. Chavez won important victories to raise pay and improve working conditions for farm workers in the late 1960s and 1970s. Chavez knew firsthand the struggles of the nation's poorest and most powerless workers who were not covered by minimum wage laws. Many made as little as 40 cents an hour and did not qualify for unemployment insurance. In September 1965, the NFWA launched a strike against California's grape growers alongside the Agricultural Workers Organization Committee, a Filipino-American labor group.
Yes, sure, it puts them in a bind because they can't sell the grapes at a profit. And we've cut down the amount of grapes being sold has been cut down considerably. And last year, as an example, in Delano, the grape growers found themselves with about 3 million boxes of surplus grapes they couldn't do anything with.
The strike lasted 5 years and expanded into a nationwide boycott of California's grapes. The boycott drew widespread support, and Chavez led a 340-mile march from Delano to Sacramento in 1966.
It's a very long march, and it's going to be difficult, but we're determined that it's best that if we're going to get the message to every single worker that we have to walk. We can't fly and we can't drive because driving and flying is just too rapid. And we have to try and visit them when they work, eat with them, try to be with them and in any way that we can.
And undertook a well-publicized 25-day hunger strike in 1968.
Now let me just say one word of warning. This is not going to be done overnight. This is not going to be done because this subcommittee comes out here and holds hearings. That you're going to expect 5 days from now, or a week from now, or 2 weeks from now, that these problems are going to disappear. Because that's not what's going to happen.
Do you think the farm worker is getting a raw deal presently?
I think that the farm worker here in the United States has not received the benefits of the rest of our society that the other workers have.
We want them to know that we're here, we're alive. And we'd like to remind them that however powerful and however strong they may be, and however rich they may be, that if we, the farm workers, do not till the soil and plant the seed and harvest the food, they would not be able to eat.
The grape strike and boycott ended in 1970 with the farm workers reaching a collective bargaining agreement with major grape growers that increased the workers' pay and gave them the right to unionize. In 1972, he went on a second hunger strike to protest an Arizona law banning farm workers from organizing and protesting. Thanks to the UFW's efforts, California passed the landmark Agricultural Labor Relations Act in 1975, giving all farm workers the right to unionize and negotiate for better wages and working conditions.
We have a mentality in our nation, it's been there for a long time, is that we want quick fixes. Everything should happen quickly and effortlessly. For instance, that there's solutions. If you make a law, pass a law, that ends the problem. But we know it doesn't. In our own time, we have experimented with them, and we have found, in fact, to us, who are surrounded in our efforts to bring about decency and justice to these people.
In the mid-1980s, Chavez focused on the UFW's efforts on a campaign to highlight the dangers of pesticides for farm workers and their children.
Well, we have many cases, many affidavits of cases where workers have been poisoned by pesticides, where they have serious illnesses. It's almost, you might say, an everyday working condition with farm workers. And also there's, of course, many reports of deaths that have been caused by pesticides. It is, right now, it is an occupational hazard, and we don't think that the poisoning and the deaths should occur to the extent that they are occurring now. We believe that something can be done about this. But of course, in order to do this, we have to have the cooperation of the employers.
In 1988, at the age of 61, he underwent his third hunger strike, which lasted a total of 36 days.
In 1984, the United Farm Workers Union called for a consumer boycott of table grapes. Cesar Chavez is in New York, the world's largest consumer of grapes, to continue that crusade and speak about the dangers of pesticides. It is a cause he risked his life for during a 36-day hunger strike in 1988, and we're pleased to have him here to talk about his politics and his protest and his life. Welcome.
Thank you.
Good to have you here. Tell me what you hope to accomplish. I mean, it's been all 7 long years for you. And a lifetime devoted
to
farm workers.
This is our third boycott of grapes.
Right.
We won in 2 previous occasions. One took 5.5 years the first time, and 3.5 the second time. To win means get the growers to the bargaining table and deal with the issue of pesticides as we've done before. We want the pesticides that are causing the big problems with cancer and birth defects eliminated. We like very much to have the whole thing turn into some... turn grapes, have them raise the grapes naturally, we could. In 1965, we made a demand that they stop using DDT, and we were told they wouldn't because they couldn't hope to raise grapes without DDT. They did in 1970 when we beat them. The boycotts have a way of developing their own life, their own existence, and it's, you know, it's getting, we feel, we see a lot of signs now that we've experienced from the other boycotts. So it looks pretty good. We're very hopeful.
Chavez died in his sleep on April 23rd, 1993, at the age of 66. The following year, President Clinton awarded him the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian award, in a sign of the labor leader's enduring influence. Barack Obama borrowed a Chavez slogan, "Si se puede," or "Yes, we can," during his successful run to become the first black U.S. president. In 2008.
We are here to celebrate the life of an American hero. Cesar Chavez was a man who devoted this brief time that we have on Earth to making sure that this country lived up to some of its lofty ideals. The words of our founding. The idea that all of us are created equal. A man who organized others to widen the circle of opportunity. Not just for the people he knew, but for future generations.
Chavez was survived by 8 children and 31 grandchildren.
I did not have the honor of knowing Mr. Chavez, but I'd imagine that he'd be pretty proud to know that his granddaughter works in the White House. And not only... she also does just an extraordinary job carrying on his work, organizing people, but now all across the country to engage on issues that are of importance to all Americans.
Thank you very much. Muchísimas gracias. Muchísimas gracias.